My name is Arthur Flug, and I welcome you to the Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College. This event tonight takes on a historic meaning, not because of the size. I think this is one of the larger crowds we've ever attracted to an exhibit. But what's important about tonight is this time next year, when you receive an invitation to come to the exhibit, I won't tell you what the exhibit is, even though we're working on it. When you come to the exhibit for the full semester at the Holocaust Center, you're not going to say, do we have to walk up the hill? And you're not going to say, how come the elevator doesn't work? And how come parking is so far away? What you're going to say is, what a beautiful new building this is, and it's going to be right to my right at the parking lot. It will be a short walk from the parking lot into the new Kupferberg Holocaust Center, and that is where we're going to have a major exhibit for the fall semester. So that is really something that we're all looking to. There's a tremendous... And there's a reason why that happened. It took a lot of planning, determination, and someone who knows how to go through administration and make the correct calls and raise the money and get the people involved. And I'd like to introduce the person responsible for that, the president of Queensborough College, Dr. Eduardo J. Marti.
Thank you, Arthur, and thank you for those kind words. It wasn't me. It was all of us who did it, all of you. And we're going to have a very, very major celebration. Rabbi Eisenberg, one more time, congratulations on a very, very fine exhibit. And I know that we have a speaker, and I know that you want to enjoy the exhibit and ask questions and participate, so I will make this welcome very short. Let me just simply say welcome, and let's wait until we get into that Holocaust Resource Center about, what is it, September? September we'll do it. Okay, great, thank you.
The Yellow Star, tonight's exhibit, From Star of Shame to Star of Courage, has to do with the ability and the desire of people to point out others as being less worthy, less deserving, and people who should be watched, people who should be shunned, people who should be cast out. And in doing that, we use the yellow star. I never truly understood what the yellow star meant and the impact, the emotional impact, and the behavioral impact it had on someone until it was October 18th, 1952. It was my bar mitzvah. And a few days before my bar mitzvah, we went to visit my bubby, my grandmother, in Williamsburg. And after going through a half hour of having each cheek pinched and getting kiss upon the forehead, she presented me with something. And what she presented me with was this. All of you probably know what it is. It's a talus bag. For those of you who may not know what a talus bag is, it is a bag that you keep your prayer shawl in when you go to services. And she gave it to me, and the following Saturday, the date of my bar mitzvah, I got up early in the morning and practiced my haftorah, I think, for the 50,000th time to make sure I wouldn't make a mistake. Got dressed, and my family and I walked down from the apartment that we lived into, and we're on the street. And I'm very proudly carrying my talus bag, and my father says, wait a minute. I said, what's the matter? I thought, you know, straighten the tie. Was the hair parted or something like that? And he said, turn it around. In other words, instead of carrying it with the star sticking out, turn it around. And, you know, being an obedient son, I said, yeah, Dad said so. So I turned it around. I said, why? He said, you don't have to advertise. And what he was saying was based on his experience. Growing up in a small town in Poland, you didn't advertise in any way that you were Jewish, who you were. Best that they didn't know. And up until the day he died, that was his practice. It took me a long time to get over that, to say it's okay if you wear it with the star sticking out. But that was branding. That was targeting people for who they were. And even though he lived in the U.S., it was still that feeling that when you carry your talus bag, turn the star in. Now, 2 weeks ago, I found myself at 8 o'clock in the morning at Young Israel of Kew Garden Hills, Rabbi Schoenfeld Synagogue. Rabbi Schoenfeld is someone known to all of you. He's also one of the founding members of the Holocaust Center. And the rabbi was giving a lesson after the morning services, and I sat down, figured the lesson would be over and we could conduct whatever business we had to, and he was giving a lesson on the use of the shofar on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. For those of you who don't know what a shofar is, this is the deluxe size shofar. You know, when you see a shofar like this, that's really a shofar. That's the epitome. And what they were saying was that when you take the shofar, the ram's horn, and you sound it for Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur, there's a certain way you're supposed to do it. But he pointed out that the law that he was reading said it's preferable that when you blow the shofar, you get one that's curled and round, simply because that was the kind that Abraham used. That was the kind that Abraham used. And one man sitting at the table said, I'd like to point out something. He said, in Berlin, at the synagogue we went to, my father was the person who blew the shofar on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. When the Nazis were in power and they started looking for Jews, he made a change. So on Rosh Hashanah, instead of proudly carrying this big shofar, he carried one this size. He could put it in his pocket, conceal it, and use it when he got to the synagogue, and nobody would know the difference. Nobody would be able to recognize who he was. Okay? This whole concept of targeting comes to the forefront with probably one of the most insidious symbols ever devised, and that is the yellow star. Tonight, we're most fortunate that when we decided to do an exhibit on the yellow star, we went to the person who would put the exhibit together in the most appropriate and effective way, and that is our scholar in residence, Rabbi Isidore Eisenberg, and I'd like to call you up, Rabbi.
Hello, everyone. So nice to see you here. To come and join us at the opening of this exhibit. And I want to take this opportunity to thank once again Dr. Marti and Lauder. To thank once again Dr. Marti and Dr. Arthur Fluke for giving me the opportunity to work, to research, and to bring to fruition these exhibits. This is the fifth such exhibit that I have had the privilege in putting together and curating. I think I count right, it is the fifth. We did one on Sosua, that famous town in northern Dominican Republic, about this little town where Jews settled during the war, about 500-600 Jews. We did an exhibit on the diplomats of mercy, diplomats who helped Jews during the Holocaust, of course, Wallenberg being the most famous of all, but there's a whole constellation of such diplomats, and we came upon some that were not so well known. And we did one on clergy, on Christian clergy, that also actually risked their lives, put their lives on the line in order to save Jews during the Shoah. And now I am privileged to bring to fruition this exhibit on the Yellow Star, which we opened this evening. Many people in the course of the weeks, the months, the opportunities that we have to meet here, come over and ask, Rabbi, how do you come about these ideas? What prompted you to do this exhibit and not the other exhibit? And the answer I thought would be fitting to share with all of you. Actually, I think together with Dr. Fluke about what we are going to put together. He comes up with some terrific ideas. I come up with some hopefully good ideas. We toss them around and then make a little salad and then come up with one that we feel is going to address an issue of the vast Holocaust literature and what took place during the Shoah, issues that perhaps are not as well known or popularly known by the vast majority of people, not only non-Jews, but Jews as well. And so we feel that all these themes that we have picked until now address themselves to these kinds of items, if you want, within the vast, big event of the Shoah that will illustrate, that will illuminate on those themes that people may not be familiar with. It is within this conceptual framework, then, that we put together the Yellow Star exhibit. The exhibit this evening, most of us have seen pictures of people in books that have to do with the Shoah or other publications of Jews that were wearing the Yellow Star. We have also seen it in movies, fiction movies, and we have seen it. But more than once, I said to myself, as I was watching these films, or perhaps seeing the pictures in books, I would say to myself, close your eyes. And if this were perhaps a meditation evening, a yoga class of some nature, I would say to all of us, let's close our eyes for 2 or 3 minutes and let a moving image go through in front of our eyes and try to imagine what it must have been to be a Jew in Austria, in Germany, wherever the German occupation forces ruled, to be forced to walk out wearing a Yellow Star on your arm or on your lapel. What must it have been to see a Yellow Star? You walk on 215th Street on Bell Boulevard, and three houses are okay, and then the fourth house, has a Yellow Star on it. And then you walk another four houses, and there is another Yellow Star. How did the people, the Jews living in those houses, feel like? What did it mean for these people? How did they react? Did they look back and forth to see how they are looked upon? Did people who saw them walking stare away in order not to look at them? Because many times, if you think about it, when we ourselves see people that are different from us in many ways or in some ways, sometimes we stare away. We don't look at them in their eyes. So did we look at them or did we stare away? And if we passed the house where there was a Yellow Star, did we just say, who is living here, or we just walked through by? And if we went to a dentist, and I picked the dentist because one of the photos in the exhibit is of a dentist who had to have, a Jewish dentist obviously, who had to have a Yellow Star on his door. And what about your ID? You had to open your ID and you had to have a Yellow Star. In one of the panels of the exhibit, and you'll see it also in the catalog, and I urge you to read it and to meditate upon it, I came across a poem by a Jewish poet, Max Jacob was his name. He was French. Jewish by birth, almost on the brink of converting to Catholicism, as so many enlightened Jews in those years in France and Germany and Austria were. And then, of course, the Nazis made no discrimination between those who were half Jews or about to not be Jews. It didn't matter to them. And he was forced to wear the yellow star. And he wrote a poem. And I quoted part of the poem. You'll read it, you'll see it. Look at it carefully. He expresses what it was for him. Somebody who truly wanted to take off the mantle of being Jewish, yet was forced not only to become Jewish, but to show it to the whole world that he was. And so I invite you to look at the exhibit carefully, to read the catalog, to meditate about what I try to convey in the exhibit, because it is not only what we read, what we see, it is not only history. It is about us in our society as well. We are constantly having to fight discrimination of one kind or another, whether it is a symbol that we force people to wear, or whether it is something they said, or even they wear some different clothing. And we look at them and we say, why does he wear this? He should be wearing like everybody else. And so in closing my remarks, I incorporated into the exhibit the testimony of a lady. The lady's daughter is a dear friend from our old shul. And her mother was forced to wear a yellow star. And as I was preparing the exhibit, she had told me the story many, many years ago. And when I came to prepare the exhibit, I said, just a minute. And so I emailed Larissa, and I said, would you double check with your mother whether I have the story straight? And she said, yes. And then as I came to the opening of the exhibit, I said, rather than me telling you the story, let Rose Gilbert tell you the story. But it goes one little step further. Because when I asked Clarissa whether she would ask her mother if she would be willing to share the story with us, Clarissa tells me just this evening that her mother said to her, I have another story about that. And says, really? And Clarissa said, well, I never heard it before. They only know each other just a short time. So why didn't you tell me before? He says, I don't have to tell you everything. So I'm delighted that Rose Gilbert is going to tell us everything. Rose?
Hello. You will pardon me, but dates, I'm not very good. I just remember that the Germans marched in 1944, in the month of March, in the middle of March, to Budapest. And in January, we were freed. But in between, what it did to us, it was just unbelievable. And in no time at all, they were out to destroy us. And so we had to have on the house the yellow star. And Christians had to move out of that building, and they were given about a week to move out. If they didn't move, then they were considered Jews, and they were threatened to be treated according. So they moved out, and in the building lived a high-ranking officer and the architect of the building. They didn't want to move. So they arranged to have the star removed, and the Jews had to move out. And moving was by a horse-drawn cart or a donkey. And that was the moving vans. And we were lined up to get one of those carts. And the highest bidder always got the cart. And then Israel entered the building three times with the officer and the architect. Three times the star was removed. And we got to wear the yellow stars. No, we had to buy them, the regulation size. I wasn't going to buy them. I didn't have the money for such frivolous things, and I didn't intend to wear it. So I figured, I look Jewish, I don't need to wear a yellow star. We were allowed to go shopping each morning at 10 o'clock. The markets opened at 6 o'clock in the morning, and by 10 o'clock there was nothing left except the rotten vegetables or rotten fruits. And if you didn't want to take them, we threw it back in the basket, get up, very Jewish. And the same thing, they gave us fat, like a kilo of fat. So we, my sister and I, took the margarine. But we took home the margarine, and it was waxed in a little layer of margarine on that ball. So we couldn't do anything with it. We went back and asked for lard. Again, dirty Jews, get the hell out of here. We don't have any lard for you. You're supposed to have margarine. And one day, in order to eat something, we couldn't go to work anymore because we were allowed to go only 10 o'clock to go for a short time of shopping. So I went to stand in line for the tenants in the building. So if I got 4 apples, then I got one of them for standing in line. The same thing, but sometimes with a piece of bread. So I didn't get paid, just got a little something. So one day, I didn't want to wear the star. So I had the star on with either pins or a basting easily to be removed. And I picked up a small child I was babysitting for, and I covered up the star with her, and that's how I went shopping. Then one day, things were drastic, and I have to report for work, what they called, for work. So I wasn't going to do that either. So my sister and I, she was too young, I was a little bit older, and we took an all-day pass on the trolley, and we were on the trolley the whole day. We weren't supposed to be out on the streets. And when it turned dark, nobody was supposed to be out on the street, so we panicked, and we met somebody who knew somebody who would make room for us in a hotel. Two young men who had papers that the circumcision was a medical necessary, and they too lived with non-Jewish papers. So, but it turned out that they didn't have room for both of us. They wanted to separate us. So of course we said no. So since they couldn't do anything with us, and it's getting dark, and they didn't want to leave us on the street, so they gave me a note and sent us to the Red Cross. The Red Cross didn't know what to do with us either, and wanted to get rid of us, but we couldn't go out on the street anymore. So we just sit down and cried. So, but they wanted to get rid of us in the worst way, because they were having a big party, and we saw champagne was brought in and food, and we were hungry. So they fed us and gave us a recommendation to the Swiss embassy. And we made our way to the Swiss embassy. Again, they opened the door, and they didn't want to let us in. So I stuck my foot in the door. And they let us in, because again, they knew that we can't go out on the street anymore. So I said, you little girls, you have to leave in the morning. I said, okay. And they let us in. We slept on the floor, and they fed us. In the morning, nobody knew where we belonged. And we stayed, and we were there till we were liberated in the middle of January. And a brother joined us who ran away from the slave labor camp. Oh, okay.
Can you imagine having to put it on, take it off, baste it again? What Rose didn't tell you is that she's a wonderful seamstress and a hat maker. so that she knows how to maneuver and put it exactly when you sew the little holes in the material, right? To put it back quickly again exactly where it was. She missed to tell you that, but I remember. Thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi, and thank you, Ms. Gilbert. In looking for a speaker tonight, we had a large number of speakers to draw from. We had any number of people from elected office. We had other community leaders. But what we did have access to is someone who's very unique. Those of you who are familiar with the Holocaust Center may have come to realize that when we teach the Holocaust to both our students and to the community members such as yourselves, we do not teach it as a history lesson. We teach the Holocaust as the greatest hate crime ever committed. And because we teach it as the greatest hate crime ever committed, one of the life skills, life survival skills we teach our students is, what do you do if you are a victim of a hate crime? The first lesson I ever got of that was when I first started teaching. I taught in a school that was called the 600 School. This was some of you, you know, said, oh yeah, they were saying, lucky I didn't get assigned there. This was a school for junior high school kids, and the next step was jail. And if a hate crime occurred there, there was a very simple way of settling it. You ran out of school, you ran down the block, you got all your relatives together and brought them to the school and find out who the person was who offended you. And it would be settled there, only to find out that the following morning, the person who received the punishment had his family there, so it was an ongoing thing. One of the people who has been most effective in working against hate crimes and protecting people and providing them with the information of how to address a situation that you think is a hate crime, which was something denied, absolutely denied, to the Jewish community of Germany as well as the Jewish community of Europe, is Joel Levy. Now let me tell you a little bit about Joel Levy so you'll understand. Joel Levy is a longtime Jewish community activist, former U.S. State Department official, is the New York Regional Director of the B'nai B'rith Anti-Defamation League. I could go on and say more, but his quality of work and the reputation of B'nai B'rith is such that I really don't have to say more. You know what B'nai B'rith stands for, and anyone who is the regional director, you know that person has to be outstanding. So Joel, could I ask you to come to the microphone? Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. Can you hear me? Your microphone's okay, good. It's really a pleasure to be together with you here this evening for this very, very important exhibit, and to know that the Holocaust Center here is doing this kind of educational work and doing this outreach into the community, bringing so many people together. This is very important work, and I applaud what you're doing. I had a very close look before coming here this evening at the draft of the catalog that the Rabbi had put together, and find it very, very impressive. You've done some wonderful, wonderful work. And I don't want to repeat, because the exhibit speaks for itself, but just to tell a very, very brief history of the Yellow Star, something that I don't think most of us realize. In our minds, we associate the Yellow Star with the subject that has been discussed already. It is related to the Holocaust, to the Shoah. It is related to the exclusion of Jews from society, to the humiliation, to the separation and degradation of human beings, to making them less than human beings. That's what it's all about. That is the lesson of the Yellow Star. That is the importance of this exhibit. But I just wanted to say a few words that the Yellow Star was hardly invented by the Nazis. It didn't begin with the Nazis. It actually is something that goes back to the Muslim period, the first evidence of something like a yellow star. It wasn't exactly a yellow star, but it was the predecessor for it. It was white, something that Jews had to wear on their clothing in Baghdad, goes back to the 9th century. It was something the Muslims did to both Jews and to Christians, actually. Again, the same concept, to exclude, to segregate, to identify people as you are not part of us. We tolerate you, we allow you to live here, but with restrictions, with conditions. And that tradition, which began in the Muslim community in the 9th century, continued in the Middle Ages in Europe. It was taken over by the Christians to segregate Jews. It began really in many, many places. I'm not going to go through the whole history, but just to mention, for example, King Edward I in England in 1215 actually had the first yellow star. And shortly after he became the king, he had financial and political reasons to exclude the Jews, and eventually he actually excluded the Jews. He kicked the Jews out of England. They were gone for more than 360 years and readmitted only by Oliver Cromwell, who also had financial reasons for doing that. But throughout the Middle Ages, beginning in that period and in many, many other places, in Germany, in Poland, in each country, the symbol of the yellow star in many different forms was used. It was always used to make a statement. And the statement is the same lesson that Rabbi Eisenberg spoke about. The Jews are somehow subhuman, somehow less than deserving of being full members of society. It was not something, interestingly, that Hitler had in his original plans when he came to power, not in 1933, not in Kristallnacht in 1938, not in 1939. The first yellow stars were really used by the Nazis only in 1940, once the war was going, and once they had occupied Poland. The first application of the yellow star was in different places in Poland on a large scale, and there were different versions of it. I know that there are many Holocaust survivors in the room, and you probably have different experiences, but I'm just saying in a central way, the Nazis, there were instances before that, but the Nazis didn't use the yellow star on any large scale until they occupied Poland, and they had different versions of the yellow star in different places. The yellow star became the standard thing really during the occupation of Poland, and then spread to everywhere they were as a way of identifying Jews and making Jews stand on the street and always be identified. Imagine the humiliation, the shame, the fear, the danger of walking on a street with something that had to be placed in a certain part of the body. And in some places they insisted it also be put on the back, so that in case, as Mrs. Gilbert told us this story, in case somebody was able to somehow cover the star, there'd be another one on the back in some places. It was not universal in its application. But it was an additional challenge to Jews to survive in Europe, having this visible mark on the outside of their clothing, and it was something that people had to carry with them as long as they were able to survive, whether on the streets, later in the ghettos, later in the concentration camps, in the death camps. This symbol went with them all of that period of time. It is also, in a certain sense, never a point of pride, but it is something one can look back upon today, in hindsight, to say, in spite of all of that, that there were some people who were courageous, who were witty, who were able to find in the circumstances in which they were ways to work around that and to survive and to have even preserved some of those awful yellow stars. We can find them in the Museum of Jewish Heritage, we can find them in the Holocaust Center, we can find them in the Holocaust Museum in Washington and in other places. I think it's very, very important. It is one of our obligations as Jews to always remember. We are commanded, one of the most important commandments is to remember. And I think this exhibit contributes tremendously to our memory of that very, very painful, difficult time in which so many of our people were murdered. Fortunately, some people did survive, and the yellow star is one of those symbols which, you're correct, is not focused on frequently enough. There were worse things that happened than just the yellow star, but the yellow star is a symbol that reminds us of all of the horror, degradation, humiliation, and actual genocide against our people of that time. So I think you've done a tremendous service to all of us by putting this exhibit together. I hope lots of people will see it, and will certainly, people who come here and people who cannot come to the exhibit can read the wonderful catalog which tells this important history which everybody needs to know. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Joel, for the words, and thank you for your ongoing support with the work we do at the Holocaust Center. Before we go to our next part of the program, I'd like to ask those of you here in the audience tonight who were ever forced to wear a yellow star, please stand up. Please stand up. Okay. Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, now, one of the really good bonuses that I get on this job is the fact that I get to meet an amazing group of people, absolutely amazing group of people. And they're amazing by not only what they've done, but what they continue to do. And you see, you know, You get to a certain age, and I know I reached that age a few years ago, where so much of the mail I got said, are you ready for retirement? You know, is your 401k where it should be? Do you have a health plan once you get older? Is everything taken care of? Are you going to be a burden to your children? And yeah, I probably will be, but what happens is we have a large segment of our community here that is a continuously ongoing and active, not only in what they do, but in the causes they undertake. And we work with these people. For example, the first one I want to call up is a woman who, every time I see her, I want to salute because she's always wearing her uniform. And that's Hannah Dodge. Hannah, would you come up here, please? Hannah, the first time I met, we wanted to have a program honoring the Jewish War veterans of Queens County. So I went online, it said the Jewish War veterans, Queens County, and they had a number, it said commander, and I called up, and a woman answered. And I said, I'd like to speak to the commander of the Jewish War veterans. Now my wife would have said, you're very chauvinistic. And she said, you are speaking to her. And I said, well, I'd like to meet you. And Hannah lives in Jackson Heights. And I went over to her apartment. We spent a good deal of time together. And Hannah told me of her story of leaving Europe, going to Canada, becoming a nurse, coming to the United States, raising a family, but getting involved in the Jewish War veterans to the extent that not only does she do the fundraising and the membership organizing, but Hannah is one who has taken over, and we're looking at the commander of the Jewish War veterans. Now, when we announced this, one of the people who's a very, very good friend of the Holocaust Center, Assemblyman Mark Weprin, called me And he said, you know, I love that woman. I said, that woman is wonderful. I want to come down. I want to make the presentation to her. And we said, fine. You have to be very nice. Mark is very nice to us, so we always work closely with Mark. Except this morning at 10 o'clock, Mark had to go into the hospital for some knee surgery. He was, from what I understand, he was overly athletic. And as a result, he's not able to be here tonight, but I'd like to call on one of his staff members, Ari Grishman, who is here on his behalf and is going to present the citation to her. And Dr. Marti, would you like to come up and assist in this? And it says, the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Resource Center and Archives presents this citation to Hannah Deutsch, Commander, Jewish War Veterans of Queens County, for her steadfast leadership in bringing to the community an unflagging dedication to the worth of the individual. Hannah, mazel tov.
Okay. Now, let's get over here. Come over here, Hannah.
Another person who, you know, it's like everybody you work with becomes your friend because they're such interesting people and have such great stories. We are very fortunate in the Holocaust Center in the number of volunteers we have. We have volunteers who come in every day doing clerical work, shipping out materials, volunteering to speak in schools, a lot of times telling me what to do because there are certain things, even though I'm the director, I don't know what to do, like what button do you press here to make these various things happen. But one of the people we've come across who becomes part of our internship program, every semester we select a number of interns. And these interns come in and they study about the Holocaust. They're trained to interview Holocaust survivors, and then I go ahead and I match them up with the survivor. What we would say, we make a shidduch. And what they have to do is get to know who this person is that I have matched them with. When they begin the interview process, I'm in touch with them and I interview them. And I ask them, so tell me, what did you find out? And they all come up with the same answer initially. You know this old guy you gave me? They're not saying this out of frustration, but you know, when you're 20 years old and someone's 40, it's an old guy. Think of someone in their 80s, how old they must be. They say, you know this old guy? Do you know what this old guy did? And when they start telling the story, I said, yeah, I know what the old guy did, but just remember, this old guy, when he did this, same age you are now, and I pose the question to them, can they do the same thing? And they're all very honest, and they come up and say, I don't know. I don't know. One such person that I'd like to call up here, Eddie Weinstein. Eddie, Vincent, are you here this evening? Vincent, come on up, Vincent. Now, Eddie is part of a team because this semester, Eddie teamed up with Vincent Wheeler. Vincent is one of our students on campus. Not only did Vincent say to me, do you know what this old guy did? Vincent went ahead and said, did this really happen? That shows great insight. Did this really happen? And I said, yes. And his next question was, how could something like that happen? Vincent was so moved by his story, his interview with Eddie, that Vincent has taken it on himself to speak to anyone who will listen about the Holocaust. He said he's spoken to his parents, to his family, even mentioned about his church, and he came in. And it's one of the things that we always worry about. What we always worry about is what's going to happen to the message of the Holocaust? Who's going to carry it on? And look at this duo up here that we have, this old guy and this young kid. Now, before I read Eddie's comment, what we've written on the citation that we want to give him, I want you to be aware of some of the things that Eddie does. Eddie will speak at any place, anywhere, on the Holocaust when he's invited, at schools, at religious organizations, at social organizations. Eddie also, yeah, he just reminded me, he has a speaking engagement tomorrow in Manhattan. Yeah, I'm not paying the cab fare, Eddie. Okay, and what he does is, not only has he done that, but Eddie has the unique distinction of being one of the Holocaust survivors who's written a book. Written a book published by Yad Vashem called Escape from Treblinka. It may have been enough to escape from Treblinka once. Eddie did it twice. Okay, and his book is there. So let me just read to you what we'd like to do. And Dr. Martinez, we have one of our students here. Why don't you come up and help us on this? It says, this citation presented to Eddie Weinstein, Holocaust survivor, for transmitting to countless students his Holocaust experiences and thereby endowing them with a fervent appreciation for the worth of each individual. Eddie. Okay. Now, Vincent, I said to him, would you like to say something tonight? Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Now, that's a lot to do. I want to read what we wrote here, and then I'd like to ask Vincent to extend a few comments that he wishes to do. And it said, we present this citation to Vincent Wheeler, Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center intern, for providing insight and leadership to his generation in understanding and combating the impact of unbridled prejudice. Vincent. Let's start here. Okay. Vincent, all you have to do is speak into the mic in a loud voice.
Can you guys hear me? Okay. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Webster's Dictionary defines the word survivor to remain alive or in existence, or to continue and function and prosper. I believe next to the word, the definition and the pronunciation, there should be a picture of Eddie Weinstein. Mr. Weinstein has defied the odds countless times. He has escaped the immense devastation of the ghettos, has persevered through the horrors and apocalyptic atmospheres of concentration camps, endured depression while living in a hideout with his father and friend, and has known fear not only being shot, but of 15 soldiers aiming rifles at him, not knowing whether he will live or die. When you ask Mr. Weinstein how was he able to escape, he just smiles and lifts his shoulders and says, I was lucky. I believe his survival is nothing of luck or of good breaks. His survival is nothing short of the many blessings that God can provide. When he tells his story, it's more legendary than, I would say, the lore of Brett Favre on Monday Night Football. But yet he tells it modest, calm, no theatrics, just the truth. There's no 2020 doing a special on him, no Charles Gibson or Charlie Rose interviewing him, no movie star like Shia LaBeouf playing him on a silver screen. There's no 60-minute segment of his life. Yet he tells the story over and over, not for fame or praise, but for people of different races, religions, and different backgrounds that separate us, to unite, educate, and understand that even under the harshest, unimaginable conditions, you can survive and live on. When I first met Dr. Pflug and participated in this internship, I thought it would be a quick $300. Not gonna lie. But going through the sessions week after week and meeting Mr. Weinstein, I've learned to value everything that I have. My possessions, my freedom, my friends, and most of all, my family. I've learned to accept me being a human being and appreciating others, not for the color of their skin, but just because they bleed the same color blood that I do and they breathe the same air that I do. Throughout this internship, I've heard many stories with the same depressing, heartbreaking line. That was the last time I saw my mother, my father, or my sister, or my brother. I have walked away with this internship with a conclusion dear to my heart. I and many of my peers are truly blessed. I would like to thank and honor Mr. Weinstein for the conversations, the stories, his honesty, and his wisdom. I remember a speech he did, and he said that his grandchildren are the answer to Hitler's final solution. I would like to rephrase that and say that Eddie Weinstein is a true answer to Hitler's final solution. Thank you.
Look at that. Hey. Come on. They're standing up for you.
No, right?
Okay. You'll give me a copy of that before you leave, okay?
Send it to you.
Okay. No, you get this. You get this. He said, was it okay? Yeah, it was okay.
Okay.
It really was okay. Next, one of the people that I knew for many, many years as an activist in the Queens community, now has risen and served as a member of the Holocaust Center Advisory Board, is Dan Drum. Dan Drum is someone who started off as a teacher, undertook an amazing, amazing responsibility in creating the Queens Gay Pride Committee. In doing so, he faced outstanding harassment, discrimination, and downright meanness. But he has persevered. And in doing so, the Holocaust Center has worked with Dan in setting up programs regarding prejudice and discrimination that goes beyond the Jewish community. Because we truly believe that the Holocaust has a message for all communities. And when we initially began a program with the Nazis and the gay community, I contacted Dan, and we had it off campus. One of the problems we have in the evenings having a problem on campus, as all of you know, is parking. And we expected a big turnout, and Dan said, don't worry, I'll get it for you. And we put together a program having to do with a film called Hitler and the Gay Community. 175 people showed up, and they paid. Okay, and we had a program that was absolutely amazing with people getting up and talking about their experiences based on what they saw that took place during the Nazi regime and its relationship to the gay people. Dan has grown greatly in that position, is recognized as a great leader in the Queens community. And Dan, I'd like to call you up. And Sandra Peterson, would you come up, please? Deputy Chief of Staff to Councilman David Weprin. Dan, come on up, please. Dan, this is really big time. You got a city council proclamation. Thank you. Thank you so much.
And Dan, let me read ours to you. It says the Harry and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Resource Center and Archives presents this citation, the Honorable Daniel Drum, Chair of the Queen's Gay Pride Agenda, for unflinching dedication to preserving the dignity and appreciation of our most diverse communities. Isn't this wonderful getting up here doing that? We have such really great people that we work with. And, you know, I know Dan's mother because she comes to so many of our events that, you know, she's a member of the Holocaust Center. And I see just walking in, I'd like to call up Councilman David Weprin. David is one of the truly outstanding people. In fact, David was one of the key people that led the program for funding of the Holocaust Center, enabling us to put together a new Holocaust Center. So, David.
Thank you. Did we present this yet? Okay. Well, we'll do it officially. I know Speaker Christine Quinn could not make it, but she made sure that I came. I had two other events, but I apologize. I actually had to come from Manhattan, and anybody that's been in Manhattan this week knows what's going on with the traffic, and the president was in town today, and that person we won't mention, who doesn't even deserve recognition, and many of us were at the protest at the UN, and really the hatred that he espouses against everyone, but in particular against the United States and Israel, is really the opposite of what the Holocaust Resource Center stands for, because we really stand for tolerance and not giving in to prejudice and discrimination and hate against anyone. And, of course, a hate crime against one group is really a hate crime against all of us in every group, because, as you all know, it's one group one day, but it'll be another group another day. But I'm particularly proud of the work, and I'm looking forward to the opening of the new Holocaust Resource Center, which I had a little part in with the city capital money, over $1 million of city capital money, but I'm really, it's really only came about not only because of Dr. Arthur Flug, but really because of President Eduardo Marti, who really made it a real crusade and said that, you know, we have to have a new building and we really have to really show and take the Holocaust Center out of the basement where only a few insiders could really take advantage of it, and really bring it up to the front. And I'm really looking forward to that, to the grand opening, because we really have to remember, least we forget. And I know none of us will forget, but you know, as the generations get older, and it's so important that we teach about the Holocaust to our children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren and continue that message. But if we could do another photo op to Danny. Danny, can you come up? It gives me great pleasure on behalf of Speaker Christine Quinn and myself to present Danny Drum with this official City Council proclamation, which even if I could read it, it's such small print because there's so many whereas clauses, I couldn't possibly read it anyway. But it really talks about really what a great individual Danny is, and he really fights for discrimination against everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Thank you so much for your ongoing support and your presence here tonight. Let me pull a few things together in closing. For those of you who are not members of the Holocaust Resource Center, let me take this opportunity to make a deal, okay? Let me offer you an offer you can't refuse, okay? For $18, you get 16 events, 6 lectures, 4 movies, 1 concert, 1 rally at Kristallnacht, and an invitation to the largest Seder held in New York City, over 250 people, that commemorates the Seder that was held in the DP camps of Europe in Munich at the end of World War II in 1946, with a free meal, a kosher meal, with a canteen. You know, this is getting, you know, we're really putting the pressure on, you know. If you haven't joined the Holocaust Center, now is the time to do it. And there's staff members in back who gladly give you the forms. We even can use credit cards. How? Now, the next thing, upcoming events that you should be aware of. October 12th, movie narrated by Theodore Bickel, The Lost Wooden Synagogues of Europe, opens up a whole dimension of the Jewish communal life in Europe that most people are unaware of. Those of you who were at the exhibit on Sosua in the Dominican Republic, one of Rabbi Eisenberg's first exhibits and one of our very successful exhibits, we've gotten such a response and such great inquiries about the Jewish community in Sosua that in February we're organizing a trip. And we're sponsoring a trip to Sosua. An amazing place if you haven't been there. When we opened the exhibit, the ambassador from the Dominican Republic came down and spoke, and he said the only regrets that the Dominican Republic has about letting the Jews in to take Sosua was that he gave them waterfront property. Okay. But for those of you who are interested, you'll be receiving a brochure in the mail. Two other things coming up. We're going to have a lecture on November 2nd, the role of Pope Pius XII in the Holocaust, and one of the speakers will be Sister Margherita Marchioni, who is the official Vatican spokesperson for Pius XII, plus we have some great movies. I thank you all for being here. If you haven't gotten a copy of the brochure for this exhibit, please take one. If coffee, cake, and fruit, we have the exhibit here. Please enjoy yourself, and thank you again for coming.